This week, we kick it old school. We're just going to sit around, talk shop, talk smack, and generally hang out, which is kind of nice. We're going to talk about Defcon and what we're doing out there and talk about some stories for the week. So stay tuned or not.
Broadcasting live from G-Unit Studios in Rhode Island, the show where exploits run wild. Packets aren't the only thing getting dropped. Systems aren't the only things getting hardened. Functions are the only things getting wrapped. And bits aren't the only thing getting banged. And those cocktails, they flow steady. It's Paul's Security Weekly. This episode is sponsored by NetSparker, the developers of the only false positive free web application security scanners, enabling you to automatically identify vulnerabilities and security flaws in all your websites, web applications, and web services. NetSparker scanners are available in two editions, NetSparker Desktop and NetSparker Cloud, the enterprise-level online scanning service. For more information, visit their website at netsparker.com/securityweekly. Brought to you by Pony Express. Check out the Community Edition and turn your Nexus 7 into a lean and mean pen testing machine. For those hard-to-reach places, there's Pony Express. Visit them on the web at ponyexpress.com. And by Onapsis, leading provider of solutions to protect ERP systems from cyber attacks. Customers can secure their SAP and Oracle business critical platforms from espionage, sabotage, and financial fraud risks. Visit them on the web at onapsis.com. Looking for a career change? Tenable Network Security is hiring everything from programmers to researchers. Check out all the available positions at securityweekly.com/tenablejobs. If you are listening to this show, check out the following two positions, both technical and both are work from home: the Nessus Vulnerability Research Engineer and a C Software Engineer. It is now time to fire up a packet capture, pour yourself a beer, and give the intern control of your botnet, because here's your host, a man who at the tender age of 6 invented threat intelligence by actually digging to China. It's Paul Asadorian, right in the poop chute.
Welcome, everyone, to this edition of Security Weekly. I'm, of course, as Mr. Larry Pesci said, your host for this evening. Very excited about tonight's show because we're kicking it old school. That's right. We're getting ready to head out to Black Hat, Def Con, and B-Sides Las Vegas. And we're just going to kind of shoot the shit here in the studio, which is nice. Of course, Mr. Larry Pesci is here to my right.
Right in the poop chute.
And that is all Larry's going to say for the entire show.
Yep. Yes. Right in the poop chute. No, it's actually good to be back at the studio for several weeks. But there was a vacation involved.
That's
so
good. That's the vacation sound.
Yes.
Mr. Jeff Mann is here with us in the studio. Welcome, Jeff.
Thanks, Paul. Good to be here.
Jeff is, of course, expert in all things compliance. Every single compliance standard, Jeff is an expert.
Even the ones that haven't been invented yet.
That's right. He is an expert. And works for Tenable Network Security. And it's always nice to have you here in studio, Jeff. You spoke at a Rhode Island ISACA meeting today?
I did. Rhode Island ISACA.
Excellent.
It was a great time.
How many people showed up to that?
They were sold out. They had 90-some people.
Yeah, that's like half the state, dude. That's
exactly
awesome.
That's why it took me no time to get back.
That's right.
From Lincoln, like, Rhode
is
Island.
Is it far? I'm like, dude, it's Rhode Island. Nothing is far. Yeah.
I think I went from border to border.
Yeah, you did.
Pretty close. Yeah. Yep.
Mr. Joff Thayer's on the lines via Skype. Joff, welcome to the show this evening.
G'day, Paul. How are you? Yeah.
I'm fantastic, man.
I would normally say I'm looking forward to the Summer Hack Fest of Fun in Vegas, but I won't be coming this year. But I will miss you holding on to our lovely drinks and dearly looking into each other's eyes.
It was very special moments, Joff, you and I
special
shared
moments
at Def Con last year. We had margaritas and we wrapped our arms around, and then
wow,
I got drunk and passed out.
Right,
you know,
in the
so it was
right in the
pretty much almost had to carry him home. Yeah. Home being the hotel.
You think I would have learned by now that when listeners bring you drinks, not to drink all of them and then go out and have more drinks. Yes, got to watch yourself when you do that. I learned last year. This year I will not be doing that.
More than three times.
More than. Yeah.
It's so difficult to believe.
Right. A man's got to know his limitations.
It's a good segue, Joff, as we will be at Def Con this year. And many of you will be listening to this show probably on your way out there. So I wanted to highlight some of the things that we're doing at DefCon. Primarily, we're going to have a table in the vendor area at DefCon. So we're doing Black Hat training, which we're not advertising because you should have already signed up by now. We are also going to be at B-Sides Las Vegas. Nick, Karin, and I will be giving a talk in releasing IVWRT, intentionally vulnerable wireless router firmware.
Nice.
It's a lot of fun. So make sure we're on at 6 o'clock at B-Sides Las Vegas on day two of B-Sides Las Vegas. So make sure you come to our talk. It's going to be awesome. There's going to be a demo. Dangerous. Demo. I know, but there is going to be a demo.
In the poop shoot.
So I'm basically going to talk about random things and be an idiot on stage like I normally am when I'm going to present. And then Nick is going to present the technical details because he actually knows what he's talking about.
I was going to say, because, you know, does anybody need to bring you drinks during the present?
Yeah, yes, please do. That'd be awesome.
The more the merrier.
Yeah, well, then we have dinner reservations after that, so.
More drinks.
More drinks. Well, and it's at a restaurant where they have, they have the restaurant area and they have a cigar lounge in the same place as in the Monte Carlo, so I made reservations there.
Even more drinks.
Yes, so.
You know what we should probably get for you, Paul, is just a wheelchair with straps on it.
Yes.
So that.
And one of those helmets filled with bourbon.
That's right,
one of the
brain protecting helmets. Well, when you're finished for the night, we could just roll in and. Yep. Strap
yeah.
you in,
and then you can just turn the helmet over and yak and that.
Yeah, the Pimp My Rascal contest is no more this year at DEF CON, so they, might be a little harder for the Rascal.
So then after that, I'll be on day two of Black Hat. I'll be there, dressed as Mega Tenable Man. Maybe that's the rumor that's circulating. I'll be in a teal
jumpsuit,
a teal leotard. Would you call it a leotard if it's
body suit? I think it's called a teal-a-tard.
A teal-a-tard. Yes, I am a teal-a-tard. So there'll be all kinds of fun things at the Tenable booth, including video games. You just saw some on the video. Yes. We've got Mega Tenable Man. We've got Arkman, which is a version of Pac-Man, and then we've got Network Invaders, which is a take on Space Invaders. Yep. There's actually they designed these video games and wrote special versions of these video games for our Tenable booth at Black Hat. So I'll be there giving a presentation on installing Nessus Agents and using Nessus Agents at the booth for 15 minutes.
Shoot?
Right in the yes.
Okay, good.
And I'm guessing the video games are not actually 8-bit. Anymore.
Probably, I don't know. I haven't seen them.
And
so.
I'd be curious to see how large the programs are that used to be.
Yes. Very small.
Very, very small.
This is true. So that's Black Hat. Then DefCon. And that's where I want to spend a little time. Tell you what we're going to have going on at DefCon. We're going to be in the vendor area, which is in the Paris Hotel. And so make sure you come check out the vendor area. Mm-hmm. And we'll have Hack Naked shirts for sale, of course. We'll have black ones, red ones, ladies' Hack Naked shirts, which have the Hack Naked with the Naked Lady and Hack Naked with the Naked Guy, both silhouettes of respective men and women.
And one of them is you, right?
The cowboy hat guy is not me.
Exactly, the
I
other one is.
I wasn't talking about the cowboy.
That's right. The female the one, females. Maybe, yes, yeah. Yes. I will strike that pose if requested. Those shirts normally we sell on our shop.securityweekly.com website. If you put the picture, did you put it up already? I don't know if you did already, but those are shirts. So normally they're for sale for more than what we sell them for at conferences. So at conferences, any T-shirt, including Smoke Naked T-shirts as well, so you can get Smoke Naked T-shirts for $10 cash. Pay with a credit card, it's $12. So we do now accept cash and credit cards, which we didn't necessarily do that before. Mm-hmm. So we'll have all sizes, small to triple extra large. I think for the first time at DEF CON, we'll have the full range of sizes. So if we didn't have your size before, come check us out this year. We'll hopefully have your size.
Here's the other thing, Paul. You know, whoever mans the desk at the booth may actually be taught how to use the credit card machine. So with any luck, we'll be able to charge you for your T-shirt.
That's right. That's right.
Right, right. If you want one of the larger sizes, do it early.
Early.
Don't wait.
Don't wait.
Because they always
sell out.
And
I'm not charging any extra for the large sizes either.
Nope.
Which a lot of people do. So make sure you go do that. I think on the shop, they're more expensive than the regular ones.
If you want one, do it early.
That's right. Right in the poop
shoot. It's a great deal. They really are great shirts.
And speaking of Black Hills Information Security, while supplies last, we will give you a Black Hills Information Security T-shirt with your purchase of anything from the Security Weekly table at DEF CON.
Nice.
So if you buy a shirt, you get a shirt free. So you get two, two shirts
for $10.
Two shirts for $10.
Nice. Wow.
And we brought some of the zombie ones, Joff. I think John has a new design for Defcon. I don't even know what it is.
I don't know. We keep having these very, very creative interns come up with the most amazing things. So they usually are very cool shirts. And hey, you can't beat the price, right? So
John will do a run, and then he'll be like,
"Yeah, I'm done.
All right, we're doing something totally different now, and like come up with a different T-shirt idea." So we'll have some of the zombie ones, which will be going away.
Yep, those zombie ones are awesome. I love those.
They are awesome. We can turn the fans on in here.
Can't wait to see the new one.
Yeah, it's a total surprise. I have no idea what it is.
We just came up with 3 T-shirt ideas over the last 2 days at InGuardians, and they're hilarious.
That's awesome. Yeah. Yep. Okay, so then we'll have cigars. So I've got Oktoberfest cigars, and I've got Wynwood Factory Fresh cigars. These Oktoberfest ones pair with beer very well. Wynwood Factory Fresh actually takes the cigars younger than they normally would, puts them in boxes, and ships them to you. Hmm. So that you can smoke them like you're at the factory, and then let them age a little, and then smoke them again, and do that over and over again. So, and he has an artist when he was working on the factory in Miami, which is now closed. So these are kind of limited run cigars. I don't think they're going to... I think they still make them, but not in the same factory where the artists were.
Yep.
But there's awesome artwork on the boxes and everything. Nice. So they're pretty cool. So make sure you come. So cigars are like $8 a piece.
Yeah.
Which find a premium handmade cigar in Vegas for $8, right? So we also have box deals on cigars. Ooh. We also have glasses. That's right. Hack Naked, limited edition Hack Naked. And these, we'll have some Rocks glasses and some Shot glasses. And these will be on sale. What do we sell them for, Chris? $10, I think. Sure, $10. Glasses are $10.
Buy one, get one free?
No.
Damn. No, buy one, get a T-shirt free.
Buy one, get a T-shirt free?
Buy one, get a Black Hills T-shirt free.
There we go. All right.
I may have brought 5 of these Rocks glasses with me, and there's a box of Shot glasses. So very limited on the glasses. And these are the nipple logo. If you look closely, you can see a little nipple. Literally. And figuratively.
How closely do you have to look, Paul?
Yep, there it is.
Yeah, close enough with your tongue. So we'll have glasses, which is awesome.
And you were the model for that one too, right?
I was.
Okay.
He had a little bit more weight on him at the time.
Your nipple for that?
Mm. Yeah. We'll also have some vape, both devices and liquid. So the devices that we have, it's actually one over there, but it's an Aspire Premium Kit. Comes with everything that you need to start vaping. So it comes with the battery portion, with a charger, with the 5 replacement atomizers, the tank, the drip tip. Comes with everything. I've used it. You can see this one's actually got a little bit of liquid in it already. These are great devices. Aspire makes great stuff. So we'll have these on sale for $80 for the kit. $80 for the kit. And a free shirt.
All right.
And then you can buy liquids. So we've got liquids from Frisco Vape, Ripe Vapes, and Beard Vapes. So there's 3 different liquid manufacturers. And these are the highest end liquids, like boutique liquids from Craft Vapory. They're awesome, awesome liquids. And we got them all nicotine sizes. Most of the bottles, the 15 mil, I think, are... What did we say? The 50 mil was $15, and the 30 mil is $25.
Cool.
And again, they're premium liquids. They're really, really good.
So and a free T-shirt.
And you get a free T-shirt if you buy a bottle of liquid. So, and we have books, which we'll sign for you, which instantly devalues them. But we will have the Offensive Countermeasures Art of Active Defense books on sale. I think books are 10 or 20. I think they're 10. Sure.
We'll sell them for 10.
Books are $10, and you get a free Black Hills T-shirt with that.
Yep.
You can buy a book, a Hack Naked T-shirt, and get a free Black Hills Information Security T-shirt for $20.
Wow.
Imagine that.
That's pretty good.
So come by and say hello. Get some free stickers. Stickers are always free. I don't have that many stickers this year, so get there early to get stickers because we're going to run out. And then we will have Security Weekly videos playing on the screen at the table, so you can come by and make fun of the dorks that are on the podcast. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I'm going to be there in spirit.
Yep.
Even though I'm not there in person, you will that's be there excellent.
And more importantly, when you show up at the booth, ask Paul, where's Larry?
Yes.
Because that's a popular thing to ask.
Well, we ask that just about every night we do the show. But actually, he's here tonight, so it's good to see you, Larry.
Yeah.
And nobody asked Larry, where's Paul? So it's funny how that works. Nobody cares.
Nobody cares. Because they know where you are.
They probably, because they know where I am at DEF CON, they know I'm at the vendor table for most of it. So. All right.
Yeah, it was fun. It was funny. I was in the car on the way over here, and I'm thinking, you know, man, my hair's getting long. I trim the goatee and stuff. And wait, if I do the haircut, though, I'm not going to be able to get my mohawk at Defcon. And I thought about it. I'm like, I always wait forever to get my mohawk at Defcon.
Yeah.
And it donate to charity to do. Why don't I just get it at home and donate to charity anyways? So
there you go.
And then I don't have to wait in line.
It's true. So you're going to mohawk it and then just go give them the money.
I think so.
I think it's makes a good sense. Plan.
Because then I don't have to wait in line. And then I have to remember to pack the clippers because I'm going right from DEF CON to a client site.
Ooh, yes.
Not the first year. This is probably the third year in a row that I've had to
so
do that.
So you're saying the client doesn't really appreciate the mohawk?
Quite honestly, they probably won't care. But just because it's a customer that we've dealt with for a very long time, they probably don't care.
You know, sometimes you have to be good, don't you?
It's bummer. It sucks being an adult sometimes.
That grown-up stuff.
It sucks not being able to get a mohawk.
Yeah.
Oh, you get the reverse mohawk.
Yeah, do the bi-hawk.
Yeah, then I look like the manager in Dilbert.
Wow.
Or if you're old enough, Bozo.
Yep, so, I'm old enough. Okay. Or you just shave it all off and you go see Eddie Mize and he draws on your head.
I could do that.
Yep.
I still need to get an Eddie official photo.
Well, I think you just have to start growing more hair in other areas, namely the chin. Anyway. Oh, hello.
We can still talk about security now?
Yeah. No, let's talk about body hair some more. Come on.
I lost your guys' video, so hopefully we're still streaming.
Yes, we can hear you, Joff. Can you hear us?
I can hear you.
Good.
Oh, there you go. I got video.
Wouldn't surprise me if anything went wrong at this point after.
Yep, everything today. Shit. Yeah, speaking of things going wrong, of course, I get the absolute best thing for DEF CON. Poison ivy.
Because being hot and sweaty makes that better.
And carrying the little one-sided shoulder thing on the shoulder where I always carry it, and it's on the shoulder.
Oh, that sucks.
And on my stomach and my ankles.
And in the poop chute.
So are we going to talk about security? I'm just wondering.
We went from body hair to poison ivy. I thought we were on a good path there, but
it's going to be tough to segue away from all that.
How do you segue into security from body hair and poison ivy?
With some sponsors.
Stage fright? No, we're not ready to do sponsors yet.
Okay.
We'll talk about a few stories and then
Stage fright? I'm speaking at DEF CON.
Speaking.
I'm the panel moderator for the DEF CON Comedy Inception.
Mm.
It is Saturday at 6 p.m.
And this is a brand new.
This is a brand new, a whole new bag, baby.
Was there a DEF CON comedy jam or no?
So there was a DEF CON comedy jam, and we felt that we had, quote, jumped the shark, so to speak, because we couldn't do our gimmick and any of that type of stuff. And
everybody, was it a fail panel?
It was the fail panel.
Was
but
the DEF CON
it was called? It was called the DEF CON comedy jam.
Okay.
So now what's happened is we're going one layer deep. Is that a former member participant in the panel is now the moderator? And we have all new panelists.
Gotcha.
No one.
And what are you calling this new one?
DEF CON Comedy Jam Inception.
Inception.
So we're going one level deeper.
Oh, I see. I get it now.
Yes.
I'm a little dense. It takes me a minute.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So who's on your panel?
So we have Ill Will, one of the founders of B-Size Connecticut.
Yep.
We have Amanda Berlin from Hurricane Labs, Dan Tentler, as well as Blow.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to remember Chris, and I can't remember his last name off the top of my head, and Chris Sistrunk.
Nice.
So it will be fun. I know they've got a bunch of epic fails.
That's awesome.
Bunch of epic fails. We had two people that had to had other commitments that couldn't end up making it.
And what day and time?
It is Saturday at 6 p.m. in track three, I believe.
6 p.m. track three. Got it.
Yep. And we had gimmicks during the fail panel, which was, you know, bread, waffles, pancakes, any of that type of stuff. But we couldn't do that because of food service rules and union and all that type of stuff. So this year we're doing for our gimmick hot sauce tasting.
Nice.
And I've got good
Until hot you've sauce. Discovered there's a union for hot sauce, too.
These are free samples.
Yeah.
You get to come up and take your own sample, and we've got stuff that you can sample the hot sauce on. And
crackers?
The problem is, crackers, exactly. We've got oysters, crackers, and toothpicks and all that good stuff. The problem is that I need to find someone that has a car that can take me to the grocery store because while the hot sauce tasting is free, the milk and bread require donations to charity.
Yes.
Because this is some good stuff.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
What was I going to say? What else? What parties are you going to plan to go to any parties while we're out there?
You know, quite honestly, I really enjoy the whole DEFCON party thing that they've done as of DEFCON 21 when they were of legal drinking age and they had all of the suites where you could do the parties right down in the DEFCON area.
That was fun. I did that.
Yeah.
That was fun.
And they've done that every year since, and they're doing that again this year. I've had a lot of fun doing that, so that's sort of on my list. And they've got the free concert and all that type of stuff. I really enjoy that type of stuff.
We're registered for the Io Active Freak Night.
Yep, I did that one. That's always a good time.
That's the Bally's pool, blue pool at Bally's.
Yep, that's really the only thing that I've registered for and sort of play everything by ear.
We're registered for a couple of things that trainers got invited to at Black Hat.
Nice.
There's one like at a secret speakeasy in Mandalay Bay.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to that one. And then what else are we registered? We registered for something else too. I forget what it was. But yeah. Oh, we'll be at the Rapid 7 party.
Rapid 7.
Yeah.
And the Optiv party is the Tenable party this year.
I didn't get invited to that.
There's a reason. I mean,
there's probably a reason for that.
Faux pas.
Where is that? Do you know?
I can't tell you.
Oh.
Because he wasn't invited. Because
I'm not invited.
Because you're not invited.
Yep. My thought, the Telefreak party, is from what I hear, is always pretty good, and they've got cool badges, so if anybody can get
and no
me
more
one for
ninja
that.
Party, right?
No more ninja party. They stopped doing that. There was last a quote
year? Did they do one last year?
They had like an unofficial small one or something like
gotcha.
That.
Gotcha.
Telefreak has had a pretty good one last year. Honestly, the one that I'd really like to go to that, you know, quote, haven't been invited to would be QueerCon, because they always have a rockin' party.
Nice. They're listed on the official DEFCON website as well.
They are.
The Optiv party is at Light Nightclub, which I think is right in Mandalay Bay.
Okay.
I think.
You're not going to tell me when, though.
Wednesday, 7. It's before the Rapid 7 party. It's Wednesday, 7:30.
More drinks.
10:30.
More drinks.
And now you guys are making me want to come out. All this talk of partying.
I signed up for a party. It sounds like it's going to be fun. It's the Nike Get Swooshed party. On Thursday night. Nike's having a party.
At DEFCON?
At DEFCON.
What?
I think they're trying to recruit people.
You think?
I think.
What for? I mean,
I don't know. It was a party. I signed up. I got accepted.
Where was that listed?
I think I saw it on Twitter.
Really?
Yeah, there was some sort of direct mail, direct Twitter thing there. Yeah, I think you're right, Jeff. But how interesting. Nike, get swooshed.
All right, so who wants to talk about stage fright?
Oh,
I've been trying to segue us into security news.
Okay, yeah, we should talk about
stage fright, as in being on stage and speaking and having stage fright?
You mean this?
Yes, do you have an Android phone?
I have an Android phone.
Oh, that one.
I haven't actually read about Android, death by SMS yet, but...
MMS, actually.
Oh, MMS, okay.
It's MMS. Excellent.
Multimedia.
Oh, you know what? That means by virtue of me being completely rooted and my MMS being completely screwed, I'm basically safe. Yeah.
Well, it's funny. I have a company phone that's an Android, and so I sent a message to support saying, hey,
via MMS.
I sent him an email, and I said, hey, what are we doing about the bug? Yeah. Are we vulnerable? And the support guy wrote back and said, well... Yeah, we're basically waiting for the patch. You'd probably be more secure if you rooted the phone. And then a minute later he sends another email saying, I'm not suggesting you do that, by the way.
But can't you just turn off MMS?
I don't think so.
There is a way in Android, maybe it depends on version.
Well,
but
it's a company phone, so I don't.
Naked Security Blog, because someone that I know asked me about this. It's actually Rob at Libsyn, where we host all of our podcasts, and I read the Naked Security Blog post about it. And I said, it's a really good article, go read it. I'm like, but here's the long and the short of it. Basically, apply the update if and when it becomes available, right? Because you're at the mercy of the carrier, depending on your device. So keep that in mind. If you don't have an update yet, or maybe even if you do, you probably want to go to your settings and check the box that says don't, or uncheck the box that says allow MMS to be received automatically.
Now, the last time I was on the show, Santa Crangelo was asking, does this constitute an O-Day?
So is there an exploit out there?
You know, he's all about defining terms, and I just want to drink.
Well, I mean,
it's annoying, isn't it?
Here's the thing. Santa Colangelo is not on the show, so we don't have to define the terms.
That's right.
Love you, Mike.
So, yeah, if you want to call it an O-Day, Jeff, you can call it an O-Day. You can call it a one-day, a two-day, a three-day.
Of course, he likes to define terms, but technically it's a zero-day. It's not an O.
I was going to say, technically a zero-day.
Hey, if you want to call it O-Day or zero-day, I'm cool.
Well, we got Baltimore area, and O-Day is a completely different context.
I thought that was an eight ball.
For those who have spent any time with a rooted Android, you will probably know that the cellular access points are actually defined in an XML file that's in the file system, and you could actually flash your Android with whatever bootloader you have on there and redefine the XML file such that MMS is not received. So you could actually fix it yourself if you have a rooted phone. And
so is that why rooting the phone, they say, so it's not just the act of rooting your phone that fixes the vulnerability. It's the fact that when you do root the phone, it gives you the freedom to control those things like Joff said and not accept MMS. Because the checkbox that I was reading about, because I don't have an Android phone anymore. I have Android tablets, which I don't believe receive MMS. I guess if they had a cellular, I have one with a cellular modem in it. I don't know that I can receive MMS. I've never tried. But on your phone, it said don't automatically receive MMS. I'm assuming if someone sends you a message, you could say, yes, I want to accept this message, and that's not automatic, and still get owned.
Right. Well, I mean, the thing about MMS is it's a data service. It comes down from actual server sitting on the net, and it comes across the data rather than SMS, which is within the cellular standard. So that's why they have to define it in the XML file, and they actually have to point it at a specific server. It's actually a DNS URL kind of arrangement in the XML file. So it's actually quite easy to modify and or disable. And I know this because I rooted my phone so badly that I screwed up my MMS, and I had to edit that file manually and reflash it to get MMS back again. And so now I know it's very easy for me to disable that at the drop of a hat, because I just upload that file and flash it again. So
what are the repercussions of disabling MMS? Older phones can't send you text messages?
No, you just don't get MMS. I mean, you don't get... So often group messages are sent via MMS instead of SMS, because SMS is a point-to-point analogy. Would be a unicast-like technology.
Oh, I hate nothing more than group texts.
Yeah. Right, you'd stop getting group texts and spammy messages, and you'd stop getting images. But straight-up SMS, you would still receive.
You know what I hate about group texts? Sometimes you reply to it, and you think you're responding to just one person, but really there's eight other people, and you make an ass of yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not a fan of group texts anyway. And
my
so
wife's family group texts a lot, and I actually sent a message. Thankfully, it wasn't anything that like I would normally text my wife with. Her mom and her brothers were on there. It was bad. Good thing it wasn't its usual dirty text.
Was it anything like the butt dialing to your dad that time?
Yeah, it could have very well been.
So do you get calls from your brother-in-law going, dude, that's my sister?
I know. Well, you know, my wife and I have a very open dialogue, very interesting dialogue usually between us. And one time we were having one of those interesting conversations, certain body parts slapping someone in the face or something like that. And I had butt dialed my dad, and it was pretty funny.
He could hear the whole conversation was telling
him. Heard the whole conversation.
Yeah. Don't do that to your wife.
Don't do that. Like, no, it was just,
we were goofing around, Dad.
Yes.
And not like that.
No.
Yeah. This time.
And your mom had a good time.
So that's why I hate MMS.
And butt dialing.
So are we going to talk about security?
Well, we talked about the butt dialing last week. That was a big story, where the executive had butt dialed and someone had listened in and determined there was nefarious activity going on.
So what about the Windows 10 release? We want to talk about a little bit of the Windows 10 release stuff?
Sure. We talked about the automatic Wi-Fi thing that you had in there, Larry, but I want to hear Larry talk about the Wi-Fi thing in Windows 10.
So this whole Wi-Fi Sense thing scares the crap out of me. Because it shares your password key with folks in your address book that you choose to. But the question becomes now, if you share that with your folks in your contact lists, and maybe now their laptop is, can you share that with someone else? So is there any restriction as to who you can share it with down the road type of thing?
Speaking of MMS.
Yeah, I
actually got a group text from my wife's family.
Nice.
Larry, not only is that a good question, I understand that that there is encryption being involved, but where's the key management? I mean,
right. Well, it's WPA pre-shared key, but now when you transfer that PSK to other devices, nice.
Like I haven't seen that image already on the internet a thousand times of Bill Cosby in the Vanity Fair with the Confederate flag. Anyway, sorry.
Yeah,
we're trying to talk about security here, Paul.
No, damn it! I'm not gonna let it happen. opposite role. Usually, I'm the one trying to steer the conversation back to security.
Yep.
This week, it's like we're
shut up and drink.
Yeah. Okay.
is this one of those shows where we just shut Paul down and say, this is our show this time?
You know? Yeah. Well, I just told him to shut up and drink. More importantly, shut up and go make more drinks.
Okay.
So we've got this concept of multi-hop sharing, right?
Yeah. Is it possible to do, quote, multi-hop sharing? If someone shares with you and now you have it in your preferred network list, can you share that with someone else? That becomes kind of interesting. Can you revoke it? The passwords are stored in an encrypted file on a Microsoft server.
Uh-huh.
Oh, we're okay.
Okay, so that's interesting. So when that server gets pwned and somebody retrieves
all the things.
If
you run a Wi-Fi network and you want to prevent Windows 10 or Windows Phone users from sharing the passkey via Wi-Fi Sense, you can add _opt-out to the end of the network SSID.
Oh, that's safe.
Fuck no. My network is going to be called whatever I want it to with not this opt-out crap, _opt-out thing, and you're not going to use it for that. Because you know what? At this point, there will be no Windows 10 in my house.
Yeah, I think that's a... I can see why they're doing it. I can see why they're doing it from a social networking perspective, but I think that's an interesting... horribly bad move.
Yep, I think it is too.
But can you disable this functionality?
So how do I turn Wi-Fi Sense off? Yes. You can turn Wi-Fi Sense off. You can disable password sharing with Facebook, Outlook, or Skype. But it's typically not something that most folks are going to... Hit the start button and type Wi-Fi. And it's Y-Fi, not Wi-Fi. Change Wi-Fi settings in the settings applet that pops up. Click Manage Wi-Fi Settings. From there, you can tweak a variety of settings. You can turn Wi-Fi Sense off. You can disable password sharing with Facebook, Outlook, or Skype. And at the bottom, there's a list of your known Wi-Fi networks where you can opt in and opt out of password sharing.
Gotcha.
So in other words, no one will fucking do it, especially if it's turned on by default.
But we'll run Windows 10 and do it. I mean, because Windows 10 has a lot of security advantages from what I've been reading. This is not one of them.
Well, here's another question. If you opt out, if you turn it off, does Microsoft still receive the data anyway? And I bet you the answer to that is possibly yes. I'd like to do a little analysis on that, which I will do at some point.
Yep.
By grabbing a Windows 10 image and putting a Wi-Fi NIC on it. But that's a scary little feature.
Yep, if you're concerned about security, just turn Wi-Fi Sense off. Coming from this article
don't use Windows 10.
Or don't use Wi-Fi?
As long as you don't share the passkey from your workplace's Wi-Fi network, the potential security risk is low. Wait, what? You have a work laptop with Windows 10 that has Wi-Fi Sense turned on and you can share a work pre-shared key network?
Oh, wait. Let me double down on that. Wait, you have a workplace that uses pre-shared key?
Well, yeah.
That's a good point, Joff.
That's a great job.
He is a great job.
That is a great point. But there are tons of organizations. I know there are.
The smaller mom and pop shops, they definitely are doing that.
Yeah. So there was a new vulnerability or some new attacks against TKIP released about a week and a half ago, 2 weeks ago, which is actually kind of neat, and it sort of significantly reduces the barrier to attacking TKIP. And I was conversing with Josh about it, and his comment at the end of one of the emails was, well, this shouldn't really be an issue anymore because there shouldn't be any more TKIP networks left.
Wrong.
And I replied back, Josh, you make me laugh.
So some of the early wireless LAN controllers at the time, the 802.11i was just getting approved.
Mm-hmm.
You probably remember, Larry, I was working in large university space at the time. They had all possible variants in the WPA2 space and the WPA space turned on. So you had TKIP, AES, CCMP, both the original WPA and WPA2 and all combinations, right?
Wait, well, so they shouldn't have had AES with WPA because that's outside of standard. So it would have been an implementation hack. But absolutely.
And well, exactly.
And that's exactly the way I find people doing WPA2 networks. The default on the wireless LAN controllers is TKIP and AES. It should default to just AES, but no, it defaults to TKIP and AES for backwards compatibility.
And most operators don't realize or don't know that the thing's just still turned on. And yep. they don't know that they need to go in there and say, this is WPA2, AES, CCMP, the end, nothing else.
Done.
Yeah, yep. done. That you know, it's a significant challenge. It's just a matter of education, but
backwards compatibility.
Yep.
Every pen tester's best friend.
Get you every time.
And
as a pen tester, we love backwards compatibility. Yep.
We're right behind that.
Yeah,
backwards.
We fully support backwards compatibility.
We should make a T-shirt. Right, poop shoot.
I fully support. Now's a good time to bring up the poop shoot.
That's right. I fully support backwards compatibility.
Which order do you put that in? Right in the poop chute, backwards compatibility? Or backwards, right
back
in the poop chute?
Backdoor compatibility?
I'm just trying. We'll work out some intelligent
T-shirt. It's a T-shirt.
Right.
Anyway, we digress. Is there another story?
Yeah.
There's got to be.
Hacking rifles. Go.
Oh, yeah. So, one.
Oh, this
who,
seems.
One. Good. Who thought this rifle was a really good idea? Oh, wait. The company that's going bankrupt.
We covered this rifle in a previous show.
We did. It's a $13,000 rifle.
Apparently, we have a keyword cert. Like, if it has rifle in Linux in the title, Larry and I are like, we're right on that.
Yep. And so I didn't realize, so this is going to be a talk at Defcon that they're going to talk about all of the bits and bobs.
And the company's going out of business.
The company is declared bankruptcy, if I recall.
Okay.
So there's likely not going to be too many more of them around. But the rifle's $13,000.
Yikes.
Wow.
I'm thinking they were hoping to sell it to the government primarily.
Yeah. Probably. Yep. And I didn't realize it, but one of the researchers that worked on this was Runa Sandvik, who used to be with the Tor project and was one of the people that was in, I believe it was Hawaii, at a key signing party and a Tor introduction party where Snowden was. And they had a conversation about all sorts of weird stuff.
Interesting.
And yeah. So she came up in some of the conversations about Snowden and...
Hmm.
But no, I've met her before. She's a wonderful woman, and she was one of the people that researchers that made this happen.
Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, Zigbee.
It's Wi-Fi. So you can connect a nearby computer to the rifle to stream video from the site to the laptop.
Wow!
Which of course they were able to manipulate to do other things with.
So they managed to manipulate the API to retarget the rifle? Is this a correct
statement? Yes. So essentially the way that, from what I saw from the video, works is that you press a different button instead of the trigger at the target that you want it to hit. And then when the rifle is lined up and it will do some changing for you, it automatically fires. So, like, if you're shaking all over the place, and as soon as you get that point where it's lined up, it automatically fires. So it's a surprise to you. Hmm. What they ended up doing was, through the Wi-Fi connection, they were able, and I'm not exactly how they managed to do it, but the comments in the video were that they changed the characteristics of the projectile, i.e. made the projectile heavier, potentially changed wind direction and those types of things, so that when it was targeted, they would actually be pointing somewhere else.
Could they specify where they were pointing, or they could just
They had it so that they could do it very accurately. Hmm. So they had two targets next to each other, i.e. two humans next to each other, and they had it pointed at one target, and it fired, and it hit the other target standing next to them. Hmm. Yeah. Oops.
No, that's not very encouraging. No. Okay,
that's pretty cool, though.
Yeah.
Well,
too bad that it's a very isolated case, but I think interesting research.
But, but this is, you know, like, this is the future. I mean, we're going to have more and more people creating computer-controlled guns.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, some things that folks didn't think about the first time, maybe they can learn from the mistakes that, wait, never mind. What am I talking about?
You know, I it sort of begs that thought or the question. I used to always love security when it had no direct kinetic effect on the real world around us. But more and more we're seeing in the industry that these things have very big deal, very much direct kinetic effect on the world around us. You know, so you look in that rifle case, you look in the vehicle cases. Now you're looking at all of the SCADA deployments with electrical grids, power, water.
Speaking of which, I believe it's Friday. I'm speaking. I can't remember Friday or Saturday. Speaking at the ICS Village on my first ICS Pwnage. My first ICS Pwnage to talk about Modbus.
And you talk,
cool. Like an intro to Modbus and some ways you can build a lab to start playing with some Modbus stuff, with some, very inexpensively, I might add.
I'll have to contact you offline for the notes.
And I am a complete noob at Modbus, so it's definitely an introductory type of talk, which I don't think they have a lot at the ICS Village, and I think a lot of people will like that. But the interesting
good cherry.
You say that there hasn't been a lot of stuff right in the poop chute, Paul.
That's just our host.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Larry.
You talk about we're just starting to see the kinetic effect of some of the stuff. But Modbus was invented in 1979.
Josh did some stuff with Modbus.
Yeah. He's been doing stuff with Modbus for Cyber City.
Was it last week or the week before?
In fact, Josh has an awesome quote that Modbus being referred to as a protocol is an insult to actual protocols.
I think that's great. But you know, here's the thing. There is a distinction, right? It was invented back in, what was it,
1979? 1979, when security wasn't even a thought.
And it was running over serial.
Mm-hmm. That's what I was about to say. It was running over RS-232 serial
RS-45.
That's before RS-232.
But then somebody had the bright idea of connecting it to Ethernet. Whoops.
Even serial is still bad because, you know, if you have physical access, tap serial.
Captain Crunch is awesome. Fruit Loops.
I know.
Fruity Pebbles.
Yes, yeah, so right.
That's my big contribution for the show.
Fruity Pebbles, Captain Crunch. Your contribution is Captain Crunch.
I said something funny before the show. I don't remember what it was.
Must not have been all
that. We're talking about YouTube and how they pulled down one of our Hack Naked TV videos for violation of community guidelines. And I was like,
where have you guys been? We've been violating the guidelines for years.
I'm like, what are these community guidelines? And they said it was actually reviewed by a human, which kind of ticked me off even more. Because if you watch the video, it's Aaron expressing views and opinions and news about computer security. Hmm. And I'm like, okay, so there's the Hack Naked logo with the silhouette of a naked lady, but... I read through there. It's like violence and child pornography and hate speech and all that stuff that they would flag. And they actually removed the video. And I'm like, it said I had to file an appeal.
Oh, right. You had to file an appeal.
So I felt like Tom Brady. And
had to bring up Brady.
But my appeal was successful. As it was pretty much shorter process than Brady will have appealing and probably will still have appealing. But
you were facing a 4-episode suspension.
So the way it works is once your video gets flagged as violation of community guidelines, it gets pulled off YouTube. There's a strike that goes against your channel, which if it goes unappealed, it will stay there forever. And if you get so many more strikes.
Three strikes and you're out.
No, they don't tell you how many. Huh. They said if you get more strikes, you could lose the ability to upload new videos. They didn't say your channel would be canceled. They said you lose the ability to upload new videos. And I was like, well, that's interesting. Now, once you file the appeal, which my appeal was much shorter than the legal process, right? You get a box where you're limited in the number of characters you can type.
140 characters.
Yeah. It was kind of like making a tweet appeal. So I wrote it, and then I was like, oh, that's too many characters. And I wrote my one-sentence appeal to them, and they said if your appeal is rejected, then...
You get another strike.
No, you get a strike, and you lose the ability to appeal for 60 days.
Oh, God.
Yeah,
so you can't appeal your appeal,
and you get one sentence to appeal. I'm like, I hope my appeal was like, did you watch the video, and did you read your own guidelines? Because I don't see where you're putting two and two together. Something along those lines.
Did you put like you what tards on the end? Or
well, I couldn't. I ran out of space. So, and so they put the video
reviewed by a human. My ass.
Yeah, exactly. They saw the title and put two and two together, and then attempted to make two and two equal five. But they accepted my appeal and put the video back. And so there's no strikes against us, and we still have the ability to appeal should someone want to get naked on the show or something, because that would violate community guidelines.
Sure, we can do that right now.
Not that I'm encouraging that on the show.
Right in the poop. Yeah.
So that's not a challenge.
You know, was there an episode where Larry was actually holding a WRT whatever and was naked? No, he was covered, though. He was covered. Oh, yeah, he had covered. something covering his inflated balls.
Well, that's the only thing the word could cover, because, well.
Oh, I mean, yeah, here it comes.
Watch out for your eyes.
Hey, wait, we're going to get banished.
So that's my appeal story.
Jeez.
So do we have any other stories about security?
Of course we do.
Yeah, because that really wasn't about security. So therefore, I derailed you again from talking about security.
It's okay. We did the self-reaming rifle.
It's okay, Paul. It's your show.
Zen fixes another virtual machine escape bug.
This one with the CD-ROM this time, right?
Yeah, CD-ROM.
And the last one was the floppy drive controller stuff,
which
no one fucking uses.
No, but I'm told that gets installed and it's activated by default.
Oh.
And some processes use that. Some listeners wrote in, and so basically it's not what you think, like who would use a floppy. It's like it's a driver that's built in that gets used by things like when you share your guest with the host kind of thing.
Oh, fuck.
So it is a driver that gets used. And now there's CD-ROM is culprit. And now no one really cares.
Which is weird.
Like the other one that was a big hoopla and all that stuff. No one turned on the fans. We need fans.
I don't think they heard you say, turn on the fans.
I don't think so.
You could have turned the fans up when you got to make drinks, but I mean.
but it is important to point out for our listeners that VM Escape undermines the very fundamental promise of virtualization, right? Which is secure separation.
I'll talk more about that and talk about hacking cars, and I'll come back in the middle of your hacking cars. Own star.
You
discussion.
Pee again?
No, I'm going to make drinks.
Oh.
So Paul has basically now said, it's my show, but really not. Drinks. I'm giving it up. Paul's giving up his show for.
Yeah. Hey, what's this yellow frothy liquid we're drinking, Paul?
I've got a question for you guys about backwards compatibility, and I don't know if you've covered it on a previous show. What are your thoughts on SSL and TLS?
Oh, God.
Don't do it. TLS 1.2 with only strong ciphers, turn off everything else.
Right, and export RSA off.
So is that just old news and most people are doing that?
it's old news and no one's doing it.
That no one's doing
it.
Okay.
I frequently see nowadays sites with TLS 1.012 enabled, but SSL v3, the message seems to have gotten out, and they've disabled them. Now, old ciphers are still coming up for on a frequent basis, it's a concern because, you know, you don't want old out-of-date. Even the old export-grade ciphers are still turned on in some places that I've visited, and it's like, we're talking about a 40-bit cipher that's basically worth nothing. So some of those things...
So Jeff, I'm working on a pen test overnight right now, so not working during the day and working at night. So this will be fun tonight after a couple of drinks. but I'm mostly done at this point. But we did this test for the same company not all that long ago, less than 6 months ago, and basically handed him a report. And the discussion at the internal inside of the company was, we can't hand this report to our auditors. There's no way. Because this is so horribad that we can't hand it to them. Fix your shit. We're going to bring these guys back in a couple of months and retest it. And quite honestly, the report is mostly already written for me because they fix less than half of the things that were reported on, including SSL. Like, they still have servers that are running SSL 1, 2, and 3 support.
Wow.
Can you say poodle? And then, of course, they have export-grade ciphers turned on, so now we're talking freak and... It just gets worse.
So I've actually, in a lot of my pen tests, and I expect Larry does the same, and so does many now, is actually just run a straight up SSL scan or you know, there's a number of different tools out there that do it. They will just go through different versions, different versions of SSL.
Nessus is one of those tools that will do it, but yeah, SSL scan will.
It's one of those, but it'll go through the different versions of SSL. It'll tell you whether they're turned on or off. It'll go through the various different ciphers, usually that OpenSSL supports, because they typically are leveraging OpenSSL in the background.
Yep. You can actually use OpenSSL to pull all of those ciphers down.
Yeah, you could write yourself a little shell script for that matter to do it.
And those tools are
looking for it everywhere, not just on, you know, the common.
Yeah, the common ports. Yeah,
common ports.
Yes.
Yeah, oh yeah. You want to
any of that stuff. Yep. Web dev ports.
A lot of the Tenable. Paul's going to love me for this, but a lot of the Tenable Nessus plugins. Do the same thing. You can tell it to look for SSL services on all ports, and it will warn you in an SSL scan as well. That's a useful feature. But I always like to check and verify. I like to use a open source tool as well to run those kinds of scans, just to make sure that we're not getting some sort of false positive, false negative situation from another scanner. So diversity is always good. It's everywhere. And it's often still enabled on a lot of web services, and it amazes me that people are not hardening their web servers by actually going in.
Sudo apt-get install, done.
Well, that's the thing. They're just taking defaults, right?
Exactly.
Not many people go in and edit and say, I want this specific cipher and this specific version of TLS. I do. But
we are exception to the rule, unfortunately.
Right. Yeah.
Well, and I guess, you know, part of my consternation is it seems like it should be a bigger deal than it is. Because, you know, NIST, which is in all the research I've done since I'm the compliance guy, NIST is the authority on. Is that coming through? There's a good shaky beat going on in the background.
Paul's really working the drink back there.
Sounds like QueerCon.
NIST declared that all versions of SSL and pretty much TLS 1.0 and 1.1 even were pretty much
crap
and shouldn't be used. But they did that over a year ago.
Yep.
And they gave everybody to January of 2015.
Yep.
But it wasn't until PCI came out and said, we've got to update our standard midstream and come out with a 3.1, that it seemed to get any attention at all.
And even still, PCI 3.1, and you will know better than I, that PCI 3.1 still gives you a ridiculous amount of time to make that change. It's like August of 2016 where you have to deprecate.
July, but yeah, okay. Close enough.
True July, August.
But,
I mean,
and they even... because the issue within the payment industry is a lot of point of sale vendors hardwired SSL into their swipe devices, talking to the point of sale, or the point of sale talking to upstream controllers, which, and I don't want to derail things, which technically isn't a requirement to encrypt when you're on your internal network, but a lot of them throw it out there, and then they started talking about our solutions are point-to-point or end-to-end encryption, and so you know, buy us.
Okay, so let me ask you this, right?
Sure.
In situations like point of sale, are they going as far as doing mutual authentication? Because people often think in the industry that just implementing strong TLS with a strong cipher as a server-side authentication, essentially client-side verification, but as a server-side issue only, is enough. I've actually come across some customers, one actually I can count in the past 3 years, that actually did client-side authentication in the web.
Whoa.
You had to have a client certificate to use that site. Now, that's a mutual authentication, which is much, much stronger. The other thing I want to point out is that I do see progress on the browser vendors. Specifically Google, Chrome is starting to warn people about weak ciphers, weak versions of the protocol, which I think is a really good step for the browser vendors to start to step up and give people a bit of information about what's going on.
Nice.
So, yeah. Well, and to finish my thought, the PCI standard, not only are they giving till mid next year for you to have to have done something about SSL, for point of sale systems, they said, oh, well, you know, if you're using those systems, you can use them indefinitely, but
and this is the PCI Council kicking the can down the road, you have to be able, you the merchant, have to be able to prove that those point-of-sale systems are not susceptible to you know, any of the attacks that are associated with it.
So in other words, you need upgrade to TLS.
Yeah, but it's hardwired. They, you know, so the vendors are going to have to, you know, put out an update of some sort. Or
I love it when the vendors put out.
So Jeff, my understanding, specifically on the point of sale topic, my understanding of the pin and chip standards in Europe, anyway,
right,
is that they in their protocols they used authentication only, not encryption. So they were just using some sort of HMAC, some sort of hashing standard to ensure the integrity, but they weren't actually encrypting. Is that true going forward with the newer point of sale systems? Do you have any knowledge of whether they're actually going full blown encryption now?
I don't have specific knowledge, but I've never seen what I would consider to be decent encryption in any point of sale system. I had like three customers in a row a couple years ago that were all buying the same point of sale solution that was advertising point to point encryption. And I was asking them, well, you know, what algorithm are you using, and what about the keys and key management?
Fine.
And they were using a variation of the cryptography that's used for PIN encryption for debit PINs, which is called DUCKPUT, derived unique key per transaction. So basically, there's a seed key. They call it a base derivation key that gets shipped with all the systems. That is combined with something that's unique about the transaction. So use your imagination.
Transaction ID.
The amount, the ID, a date and timestamp.
Timestamp.
It's got to be something that's known on the other end, but they use some sort of unique per transaction variable combined with the base key to produce a new key that's then used for the transaction to send it. So they're saying, well, every transaction's a different key, so it's not breakable.
So you just brute force the unique.
Well, you know, I'm not, you know, I'm old school crippy, but to me, you're weakening it, because what is supposed to be a variable that's unknown is essentially a constant. It changes, but it's a constant that both sides have to know. So
there's one constant that both sides need to know, and the other portion is variable, but it's still relatively constant.
Right. So this particular vendor, and I made these customers get the vendor on the phone, and the vendor finally owned up to, they were shipping the same base derivation key for their product, for versions. Every customer that they had the same seed key.
Sponsors.
So if the same seed key means they were all in sync for every transaction thereafter, right? It's a little bit like pseudo-random number generator issues where... Mm-hmm. You know, they're seeded with one number, and they're going to generate the same sequence.
You break one, you've broken them all.
Yep. Speaking of breaking one and breaking them all,
we're going to break this conversation and talk about our sponsors, because this segment is also brought to you by Black Hills Information Security, the leaders in penetration testing and active defense. Email consulting at blackhillsinfosec.com for a request to quote today. And by Tenable Network Security, the creators of Nessus, the world's best vulnerability scanner. Jumpstart your security program today and evaluate Security Center CV, the continuous monitoring solution. Visit tenable.com. And by the SANS Institute, the most trusted source for computer security training, certification, and research. Visit sans.org to learn more.
Cool. Hey, there's one thing I wanted to mention about Black Hills, which was kind of fun. One of the SANS mailing lists the other day, there was some conversation going back and forth, like somebody wanted to, you know, talk about some boutique consulting services and who should you trust. And someone came back with any of them run by SANS instructors, like Dick Shackelford's and InGuardians.
Pretty much
Mike,
all of them. Yeah, Mike, most of them, right?
They put InGuardians, Mike Poor, Dave Shackelford, and a few others. But they had forgotten BHIS.
And oh, no.
My comment back to the list was, well, one, I'll throw my name as a SANS instructor who also works for InGuardians, and don't forget BHIS.
Oh, thank you, Larry. That was very nice.
Oh, thanks, Larry. That was very nice.
No, yeah. I mean, that's one of the things. We've always referred work to each other when times are of need, either capacity or any of that type of stuff. So no hesitation from our side to go say, hey, you know, here's some of the other folks that are in our space that are as good or just as good as we are. So, you know, that that's always things that we've done, including trusted
sounds. Notice how Larry just sort of hesitated on that. But actually, I will. Nearly as good, he said.
Then yeah, no, I said just as good.
Yeah.
No, he did say just as good.
I almost said or better, but that, you know.
Oh, yeah, I can't say that. But, you know, that just chiming in on that, we are friends, and I actually have customers that are on a periodic basis that come back, you know, either monthly, quarterly, whatever. And I'm sure in Guardians and other top-notch firms in the industry do as well. And actually, I do like referring customers over to our friends because they want often, especially the periodic retesting, they want more diversity. They want, you know,
absolutely,
give us a different set of eyes.
Absolutely. And these are
exactly.
people that we know and trust. And
exactly.
We know that we'll deliver the same quality of work that we do. So.
Shall we sing Kumbaya now?
We could. We could hold hands.
Hold hands, sing Kumbaya.
We should get margaritas and do the... Wait. That's already...
Oh, no, wait. I saved that for Vegas.
I was going to make margaritas, but we're out of lime juice.
So what are we drinking now?
Yeah, what is
this? This is a Manhattan.
Ah.
So this is rye whiskey, bullet rye. This is...
So how much of that bullet rye is left?
Not much. This is a Blanco vermouth. Mm. This is like a white vermouth. Mm-hmm. So you notice it's very mild, girly drink. I didn't intend it to be a mild, girly drink, but that's just the way it came out.
Yep.
And but you're a mild, girly kind of guy. So, you know.
I differ with Jack Daniel. I like to put some bitters in my Manhattan. He makes a lot of Manhattans and does not use bitters. He yelled at me once for suggesting the usage of bitters. And maybe it wasn't even a Manhattan he was telling me to make, but anyway, I like putting bitters in the Manhattan. I don't like Angostura so much.
You use the Peychaud?
I use the Peychaud bitters.
Yep. That's what I used in here. I use some
because it's a little sweeter and a little milder than the other one. So that's what I used.
Yep. Yeah. Knowing that we didn't have sugar for the old fashions that I made.
Oh, we had sugar under the bar. There's a whole box of it.
I didn't see it. So I used honey.
Yeah, honey works. I like honey better than sugar.
I used a little bit of the agave nectar. Orange bitters, Peychaud bitters, and lemon bitters.
Ooh,
A little bit of lemon bitters.
Addition.
And those drunk cherries.
Yes.
Anything that basically resembled fruit.
Yeah, exactly. And a little bit of sweet. Yeah. So
good. Well, you've got to take away a little bit of the guilt. That's why you throw the fruit in there. It's like it's a health drink.
Yep. It's a healthy drink. Exactly. Just like Bloody Mary's, it's vegetable juice.
Speaking of odd drinks, last week we were on vacation, I forgot to bring it this week. I brought a bottle of bourbon that was totally awesome, and I bought a bottle of rye. That was also totally awesome. I should have brought that for you guys to taste because that's all I've been drinking.
I have some whiskey for you to try, too, from our sponsor on Stoic Geeks, Defiant Whiskey.
I saw that over there.
Proud sponsor of the Stoic Geek Show. Nice. I'm going to mention here on Security Weekly, Defiant Whiskey. It's actually distilled in North Carolina. It's awesome. I like it.
So we bought a bunch of beer that was different, and I got Heady Topper.
Oh, how was it?
I have some at home.
Oh.
So the liquor store that...
you still have some left, so maybe it wasn't that good.
No, I have six left. So the deal is it comes in four packs.
Mm-hmm.
And the Alchemist, the brewery that does it, delivers to certain towns at specific times.
Right.
And it's sort of a well-known type of thing in the local area. And I was in some place, and I asked if they had, and they said no, but Stowe, Vermont, gets their deliveries at 2 p.m. on Thursday.
Yep.
I'm sorry, 10 a.m. on Thursday. So we went to the state store right there in Vermont at 10:17, and there was a line of 30 people at the cash register.
For
Heady Topper. And you could only buy one four-pack.
Wow.
So I got in line, got my four-pack, got to the car, sent my wife back in because I didn't know, sent her in to go get it, and there was only like six people in line, and they had one case left.
That's
one case.
One four pack?
That's crazy.
No, they had a full case, 24 cans. So six four packs left.
And she bought the whole case?
No, she could only buy one.
Oh, okay.
One per. But so we got some of that. We brought it home. And my brother-in-law brought a beer with us from Dock Street Brewing Company. It is called the Walker. And it has to be called a malt beverage because of the additions.
Yeah.
It is a malt beverage brewed with roasted goat brains and cranberries.
Wow.
Ooh.
So it's got a picture of a zombie on the front because it's a walker with brains.
Mm-hmm. Brains.
It was fucking awful.
How was the Heady Topper?
All right. Pass on that
experiment. It's awesome. You've had it before because not Kevin brought some with him.
Did he bring? Was that Heady Topper?
That was Heady Topper, the big tall silver can. Yeah, that was Heady Topper. Yep, it's like a double IPA type of thing. It's really good.
Excellent.
Yeah, I think I've had Hetty. Mike Perez. Big shout out to Mike Perez. He's just reminding me that he bought the topper to the show we did. I think it was show 400.
Yes, he did.
That wasn't Hetty Topper. That was something different.
No, that was Hetty Topper.
Oh, no, it was Hetty Topper.
Was it?
Now, that was not the drink that went into my laptop, just for clarification. That was a cocktail of some sort, which is why the smoke got out the other side of the laptop. But, you know, these things happen. This show, that will, I mean, that's going to go down.
Live in infamy. Yeah. Wait, can we have a repeat for the 10-year?
I don't know. I'm going to try to avoid that in the future.
I need a new laptop. I mean, I dropped this one in the concrete a couple weeks ago.
We should get an old laptop and we should pour beer in it on the 10th anniversary
while
show.
While it's on.
While it's on.
Oh, that would be fun, wouldn't it? Right after I actually poured that drink, the company came out with a whole lot of new policies about equipment and drinks. I don't understand what that's all about.
Imagine coincidence. That. Coincidence.
You're not a good pen tester security guy unless you've had a policy or rule written for you.
That's true.
For your company.
Or pour a beverage in your laptop.
Yeah, I've had someone else pour a beverage in my laptop.
Where was
at
that?
At Sands.
That's right. That was during a podcast.
Yeah, because I was going, I had to pee because I had like 8 beers.
Yes.
And I had to pee, and then someone knocked my beer over. I don't know who, but.
Did your laptop survive that, though?
It did.
I think,
it did.
Say.
It survived perfectly.
Yeah.
You poured beer
but
in
did
one.
You get to pee?
I did.
Okay.
I did. When the first time I think Trent and Bill were on the show.
Yep. Yep. Because they've joked about it doing the second one. Joff's done poured beer in his laptop.
Yeah. Yeah, I've got popped my cherry, whatever.
I smashed a laptop after the show.
Yep, we've smashed a bunch of the potato cannons.
Yeah. Maybe that's what we need to do for 10th anniversary is bring back.
Yeah, we need to have, that's right, we need to have
we need to get like a lineup of old laptops on a table. We'll have extra space because we'll be moving into the new studio if all goes well. And maybe we just get a lineup and then we'll pair a beverage with a laptop, an alcoholic beverage. Maybe one is like a 40-ounce. Maybe one is a regular beer. Maybe one is...
So it's a laptop pairing.
Can we try
it? Yeah, and we pour it in and we see which laptop handles it better.
If we could pre-record that, we can do it at my house. So in a yard.
No, do it right in the studio.
I've got tons of laptops we can use for that.
We get tons of studio space. Bring the laptops.
Okay.
We'll do it right in the studio. I think it'd be add
now,
to the effect.
Do the laptops have to actually still work? You have to power them up?
I think they do.
Okay.
Is that going to cause power issues if we start pouring beverages into laptops?
If they
GFC.
Maybe they need to run on batteries. So you unplug
them
right.
Can we shoot them with a spud gun or something?
Well, that we'd have to record in Larry's backyard. We did that before, though.
We've done that.
You did the potato gun thing?
Yeah, we did.
I could bring in an old jazz drive if you want to try that.
Scuzzy. What happens when you feed jazz drives thermite?
We know what happens because we tested that on the show. One year we hung a computer equipment from trees
and had computer pinata.
Computer pinata, we did that one year
with a pickaxe.
Yeah, but I think an official laptop pouring
beer off.
Yes, we're gonna come up with a better name than that. But yeah,
I should have got a video of my July 4th to like splice into that because we were shooting stuff off in the. And the law arrived in the street.
I think for a 10-year, we need to set aside like an hour and have like a laptop chug-off.
Shenanigans.
That would be good.
We're going to have to get some plastic bins to put them in so that it doesn't spill all over the place.
Well, put some plastic down. And
Yeah.
Everyone already thinks it's a porn studio. So they're going to see the floor covered in plastic.
That reminds me, for that episode, we've got to have our 55-gallon drum of lube.
We do. That would be awesome.
For the plastic, of course. So, how does the laptop handle lube?
We're going to make a slip and slide.
Slip and slide. It'll be a
right in the poop chute.
Yeah.
Right in the
laptop
poop chute.
Slip and slide.
Slip and slide right in the poop chute.
So we can pour beer in them and then slide them down the...
Yeah,
hey, you know what we could do? We could have the slip and slide and then like a brick wall at the other end with the drinks sitting on top of the wall. So, and make sure that the wall is flexible enough that it moves. Slide the laptop down, see if you can knock it. It could be a whole game thing.
You know what else we could do? We could actually talk about computer security on this episode.
What a crazy idea. Hey, we have
change now.
Paul, while you were over getting drinks, man, we were talking about security.
We were. You break from my shenanigans. I know. All I do is interrupt and talk about nonsense this episode.
So I get to, IMs from Mike Perez. Drinks are for people, not computers.
All the more reason why on the 10th anniversary show.
And not with Hedy, you don't.
No, not with Hedy. No, we would not use Hedy.
You don't want to waste the good stuff.
No.
I think one of them has to be like the nastiest 40-ounce malt liquor.
Clamato.
One has to be Clamato. It's a Clamato beer.
Kornmeyer. No, it was Kornmeyer and... Fuck, what's her
ABR?
Name?
No.
What's used to be on our
name?
Show.
Allison?
Allison. Oh. The one that Allison drank.
Everyone asks where Allison is.
Bud Light Lime.
We're going to get Allison back for the anniversary.
We have got to get Allison back. We miss her.
She, due to other obligations, couldn't be able to do the show anymore. Yep. For no other reason than, I mean, it's not her, it's not us. We're all still friends and everything.
Oh, but
just for reasons beyond our control and her control, she wasn't able to do the show anymore. One of them was she moved.
Yep. She was the one that told me that the Dot Wang TLD was available.
A Dot Wang?
The Dot Wang TLD.
Did you get Larry Dot Wang?
Actually, I got Smelly.
And I got Larry's big.
See, but if you got Larry, then you could do smelly.larry.wang.
Yeah, I could.
Oh, dude, no.
So
no,
I suppose you could do but Larry Smelly Wang.
Now I got Paul's Smelly Wang.
That's right.
Paul's.smelly.wang. And I also registered one day when we were here on the podcast.
What is on that website?
I also got a, while we were here on the podcast, the day that I registered the TLD.computer.
Spirit Fishing for Poop Sharks?
No, .computer. Was my computer is my other computer is your dot computer.
Computer. I love that one.
I also registered Ron Jeremy's dot Wang.
Ron, if you're listening, Larry will probably sell that to you.
So to round out our conversation before the break, nobody should be using SSL anymore.
Break from what? And we haven't talked about anything computer security related.
When you were here, we haven't.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
No. So,
do something,
security, some computer security stuff. My story, sort of two and three, are sort of a little bit of interchangeable and have some dovetails. So, the story number two, the $10 device for cloning access cards, is a device that they're proposing called the BLE key, so that you can allegedly store your NFC keys on your phone, and you can transfer those to this device over BLE. That's the way I understand it. So conceivably, you could capture a bunch of these and store them on your phone and replay them sort of at will. I'd also argue that depending on the way they've done this, if this is the way I think it's working, they could use the phone to integrate with BLE to this device to do brute force. So they could use the phone to generate a whole bunch of keys, send them, and then keep trying all of these keys, so that might be kind of an interesting thing. It's the size of a quarter for this device, and powered by like a watch battery. So it's going to be at Black Hat. They'll distribute 200
Canadian
BLE keys.
Quarter. Is that the same size as an American quarter?
It's close enough.
Okay,
it's close enough. It's actually just worth more right now. So if anybody is willing to pick up a BLE key that they're giving away at Black Hat because I will not be there and is willing to give it to me, I would greatly appreciate that. Mark and Eric from Accuvant and Faraday Future, if you'd be willing to send me one, that would be awesome. If anybody knows them and would be willing to contact them on my behalf, I'd love one. I'd even be willing to pay the $10. The other one to go along with that is that there's a new version of an implantable chip that does NFC that you can reprogram.
So you're going to plant one of those in your other hand?
I'm seriously thinking about
can
it.
Can we record ten it?
10-year episode.
10-year episode. Can we record it?
Yeah.
That would be in the spirit of
get one of these NFC chips, because that would be really neat. That if we can do the depending on which one they are, I may already have one, but they say it's new.
You want to subject yourself to that much pain again?
Yeah, do it.
How much pain was that on a scale of like 1 to 10?
It was like a 5.
Compared to all the tattoos and piercings?
It's quick, so there's no comparison.
I gotcha.
It's a
tattoo's more lingering.
Yeah, it's a five and it's over. Depending on the size of the tattoo, it's like getting a rug burn on a rug burn that you got a rug burn on.
Yeah,
it's like I heard you like rug burns, so I put a rug burn in a rug burn.
Yeah, gotcha. That's getting a tattoo, but the implanting is a lot of quick pain.
Yeah,
all at
technically
once.
It's
like it's boom. It spikes up to eight, but then it's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, how big is it, Larry?
That's what she said.
You have to go to Larry's.wang to find out, Jeff. Yeah.
Nice.
If you want to know how big Larry's implantable, you know.
It's not the size of the chip.
Yeah, you should just set up a website that just has this big bar, and you're just going to keep scrolling to the right. Just keep scrolling and scrolling and scrolling. Long and every time you scroll, it just paints more. Yeah. Just keep scrolling.
Long penis is long.
Actually, Paul, I think you've got it wrong. I think you need to scroll up.
Up and down.
Either way.
Yeah.
Up, then down, then up then down.
Hey, you do that enough times and you get a surprise.
then it rains.
It takes you to Larry's Dot Creamsicle. That was my second funny joke of tonight. I actually laughed at two of my jokes.
My name's Paul Atsidori and I'll be here.
I'll be here all night.
Try the veal.
Try the
tip your servers. That's it.
I got a question for you guys.
So, yes, Chris.
Yes, Chris.
Did you guys read about Land Turtle from Hack 5?
No, but Chris is getting one. He's going to do some tech segments on it.
Yep.
It's a whole bunch of like USB and wireless gear in a kit.
Yeah. I was hoping Kevin was going to be here because it just looks like a cheaper, easier.
Are they going to be selling them at Defcon?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I'm going to buy one then.
It's really cool.
It looks like a cheaper pwn plug, basically.
Well, but it comes with things like a USB voltage meter.
That's just in the
kit.
In the kit.
The kit was cool. I like the kit.
The kit comes with an SDR, too.
Yeah, SDR, voltage meter,
and
Wi-Fi cards, a pineapple.
A pineapple.
A bunch of other stuff. Okay. All the cables and antennas and all that stuff. It's pretty. It looked like a nice kit.
I think I'm going to have to pick one up just for pure research purposes. Non-reimbursed business expense.
There you go. Tax all deductible. These
yes.
A good toys to have.
Yes. They should have just called it all the good wireless toys to have.
Yep. And you know, and that's a fun thing. One of my students at one of my last classes told me about some Bluetooth low energy stuff from Adafruit, like the BLE Explorer, and it's got all sorts of hacking tools already built in with it, and it was like $20. I'm like,
nice.
Buy checkout right in front of class. I don't care if you see my credit card number.
It's PCI compliant, right, Jeff? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, just like
our shop.
Website, our shop, and at DEF CON. It'll be all PCI compliant.
It will be.
It'll be Square, right?
Are you using
it's
Square?
It's Square. Is that PCI compliant?
There was a guy at ISACA today that was, he took apart the various versions of Square and were showing the insides. And
of the reader itself?
Yeah. And he built his own, basically a skimmer that he put between the Square and the phone. And he actually had a sound file of what it sounds like when a card is swiped.
Nice.
Oh, yeah, because it goes in the audio port.
Because it goes in the audio port.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
But you'd notice if someone was man in the middling that.
The device that he had, yes.
Right.
But, there's a lot of empty space inside of even that little Square thing, like maybe for a chip.
Oh, that's interesting.
And they're only, and Apple only, Square is only now coming out with encryption. And of course, he hasn't even touched the encryption yet. And so I pulled him aside afterward and said, we should go after the crypto. He said, I don't know how to do that. And I'm like, I know people.
Nice.
Hey, Larry, is that Bluetooth Low Energy box, the NRF 8001? Is that the one you're talking about?
I don't know. Let me dig that up while these guys are talking.
All right, shoot me a note offline because I think I'm going to go next finished on that as well.
Yeah, well, Bind had a vulnerability that looks like denial of service. I haven't been able to read too much into it. But
yeah, that was on DNSSEC, right? It was the Tiki vulnerability.
Yes, Tiki, yes. So the quote here says, an error handling of the Tiki queries can be exploited by an attacker for the use of denial of service vector. Yeah, I don't know what else to say about that, except...
I mean, that's probably all there is to say about that. They got some code that's, probably dumping an exception on the Tiki.
It doesn't
handling.
Say whether or not you have to... Do you have to be implementing DNSSEC, or if DNSSEC is built into your version of Bind, is it vulnerable? That's a good...
That's a good question.
Yeah.
So
I know maybe not many people are using DNSSEC, but I bet you if you're running Bind, it's probably, especially in a package you would install from your Linux distribution, it's probably built in with support for DNSSEC. And even though you're not using it, maybe you're still vulnerable. I don't know. I didn't get a chance to read too much into that story this week.
Well, now Bind 9 does have the ability to either switch on or switch off DNSSEC, and so if you disable
it in your configuration, if that's yeah.
Yeah, and then the other question would be if you're actually resolving local DNSSEC enabled zones or not, whether that's an issue in the exploitability of this one. So, yeah, some more reading on that, but folks in the infrastructure business, definitely go out and read.
And we've covered it over the years. I mean, it's really hard to disrupt the DNS environment on the internet for a lot of reasons. If you go read about it, right? Anyone who's studied networking and TCP/IP communications has probably done a lot of reading on DNS and why it's so resilient. So, hey, it's done us good this long.
Yep.
There have been some attacks against the root, but no one, to my knowledge, has been able to take down the entire internet. There have been issues.
Mm-hmm,
have certainly been some issues.
Not recently, though.
Not recently. Years ago, didn't it?
There were DNS issues.
HD or someone produced some research where you could do some man-in-the-middling or denial of service thing. That was a long time ago.
Yeah, it was a long time ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is the root name servers. So, pop quiz, right? There's only 13 DNS root name servers. Why?
Oh, I don't remember. I should know
this.
Because they're
8-bit.
No, because the original DNS packets were only 512 bytes long, and that is only the amount of NS responses that could fit within 512 bytes.
Oh.
That was the reason. But here's the deal, though. It's very hard to DOS the root name services because those 13 addresses in the V4 space anyway are Anycast addresses, which means they route to multiple, if not, I don't know the exact stats, but potentially hundreds of thousands of
locations. Yep.
Yep. So, you know, that makes the infrastructure very, very robust. So that, you know, making things all that much more difficult from a denial of service perspective, at least on the root name services. But for distributed name services on individual companies, organizations, that's a different matter.
Right.
So. Nice. So, Joff, the device is the Bluetooth Low Energy Friend. So the Blue Fruit LE Friend, and it uses the NRF51822, which appears to be the same module that they're using for the $10 cloning card. Hmm. Same Bluetooth low energy module, just from looking at the picture alone.
Adafruit Bluetooth LE Friend.
Yep. So I went to
Adafruit. I'm going to have to take a look.
Yep. I went to Adafruit and I searched for Bluetooth, and it was the 5th item down. $25.
Cool.
Well, I have some more fun Bluetooth stuff coming up, so I'm definitely going to look into that.
That about wraps up the show. I want to thank everyone for coming on the show. Larry and Joff, and especially Jeff, our special guest, made the trek down here.
Sure.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for listening. We'll hope to see everyone at Black Hat B-Sides and DefCon coming up. Thanks, everyone, for listening. Larry, take us out.
Over and out.
Alec
Bunner, ride the poop shoe. Ride the poop
shoe. In the poop shoe.
Ouch.
All right.
And we're out.